Welcome, everybody. Joe Tarnowski with ECRM, and I want to thank you all for joining us. My guest today is Mark Polymeropoulos, a former senior intelligence officer at the CIA and one of its most highly decorated field operations officers. He's also the author of Clarity in Crisis, in which he talks about leadership lessons that he picked up during his 26 years with the agency, many of them spent on the front lines in some of the world's most dangerous places. So the book covers 9 principles of leadership. Today, we're going to drill down on 3 of them, and I will have a link in this post for those of you who are interested in exploring the other principles. So, Mark, thank you so much for joining us. Thank you for your service. And to start off, can you give us a little background on your time in the CIA and how your experiences led to the book?
Sure. No, of course. First of all, it's awesome being here. Thank you so much. Thank you for the kind introduction. Most importantly, you pronounced my last name correctly.
Yes.
So I start off all these talks with just a quick story, and forgive me, and hope your listeners going to love this. So I was, it has to do with my last name. I was in the Middle East, a couple years ago, and it was under the presidency of George W. Bush, and the briefers who were going down to the White House, the Oval Office, called and they said, "Hey, we need your take on this certain situation. Breaking crisis in the Middle East." So I told him this, and I was waiting by the secure phone, and waiting. And I finally got them when they came back from the Oval, and I said, "How'd it go?" And they're like, "Hey, it went great." And I said, "Well, what did he have to say about, my kind of crack analysis?" And he's like, "Well, we kind of sat around the Oval Office trying to pronounce your last name the whole time." So you nailed it. So that's we're good. This is going to be a great episode.
That's the biggest hurdle. That was the biggest hurdle. I got over it. We're good to go now.
Got over that bar. sure. So, how did I end up, at CIA, because, ultimately I was a kid from New Jersey. I was actually born in Greece. My dad was Greek, my mom was American. But I think, I ended up at CIA because, I was lucky to go back, in the summers, to the Greek islands. I was born there, but, we traveled a lot. So I had this kind of wanderlust. But the real kind of and I love telling the story, because the real key was when I was, I don't know, probably 10 or 11, my dad took a sabbatical, and he was in Algeria, a country in North Africa, and he spent a year there. And so at 10 years old, this is crazy. My mom put me on a plane from Jersey, actually probably JFK. And I fly by myself at 10 to meet my dad in Algeria through Europe. And we spend a month in a Volkswagen minibus driving through the Sahara Desert for 2000 miles, sleeping in oasis. It was crazy. So, I kind of got the bug of wanting to do something, with overseas service, with public service, and CIA seemed like a natural fit. And, I went to Cornell University and got recruited out of there. And it's the only job I ever had. So, good thing I can talk now about leadership. And I wrote a book because I don't know what else I could do. So, that's the story, though. It was all born from a trip in a Volkswagen minibus when I was 10 years old in North Africa. It's pretty wild.
So you got the bug for adventure and travel right in the beginning.
Yep.
Excellent. No, I really did. Cool. The title, Clarity in Crisis. Sure. What does that mean for you, and how can leaders attain it when going through difficult times?
Sure. So clarity in crisis is a pretty simple concept, and it certainly applied to my life in the CIA. It's a leadership principle that I learned late. I got really good, right before. This is not uncommon. I was at the peak of my game when I kind of, learned a lot and then, unfortunately had to retire. But it's the idea that you're comfortable in the gray, that, when there's times of ambiguity, that's your happy place. Like the gray was my happy place. And so, when there's a crisis, you were comfortable operating in that. And, I'll give you just a kind of a personal anecdote. Obviously, we're talking, I don't consider myself a New Yorker. I'm from Jersey, but I'm talking a New Yorker. But, I'll never forget, at 9-11, watching policemen and firefighters running into the World Trade Center.
Yeah.
And there's something to be said that when there's some kind of danger, where there's crisis, a lack of situational awareness, your training kicks in and you just do things. And so I wrote this book and then came up with these principles at the end of my career when I realized, hey, I'm really good at this. And so, when others want to flee, you have no fear, and you're comfortable in that period of gray, and that's your happy place. And it's really interesting. And what I thought was, by writing the book, this can resonate with a lot of other people as well. And so, a really good friend of mine said, "Hey, look, you're on the tip of the spear. So, but don't write this book for your fellow colleagues in special operations or intelligence. Like, you got to have like a librarian from Jersey be like, I get this, And so that's what I wrote, because it's just common sense principles. Mm-hmm. And so, and then of course, the pandemic hit, and what a, I guess not a better time, but what an amazing experience where there was so much uncertainty, and to be able to kind of navigate through that, I think is really important. So I think the book is going to really resonate. I'm really excited.
Yeah, it's definitely relevant for these times. And, you know, that's why I wanted to talk to you, because it does, it is relevant for other people outside the military. Our audience is mostly, you know, founder-led brands. It's retailers, food service operators. And I think it's really important, that principle, to kind of be comfortable being uncomfortable.
Yep,
you know, to just embrace it, because that's where the growth happens. That's where the learnings happens, is when you challenge yourself and you face those situations.
So here, let me say, say you're an entrepreneur.
Yep.
And you're starting off, and you know what, you know, times aren't great. And you know, and I love this analogy, and you got to meet payroll, right? Mm-hmm. And you don't have to meet payroll in 3 days. You got to meet payroll in 4 hours, mm-hmm. and this is so common with so many entrepreneurs, or small business owners. And you know, so my principles got to relate to that. Mm-hmm. And you got to stay calm, because, you know, you're going to get through this. But it really, I think the principles apply to all walks of life.
Yeah. And it really resonated with me, because our company itself experienced this firsthand. For 26 years, we did in-person programs, right? Where we brought buyers and sellers together. We'd have 80 of them a year here in Europe. And then all of a sudden with the pandemic, we had to pivot, and we pivoted in 6 weeks to a completely virtual program. Where we're actually doing better now.
There you go.
We were doing great before, but now it's just so. But if we weren't able to face that challenge and with a clear head, we could have just fallen apart. So it was it was really cool. And 100%. I saw a lot of that in your in your book. I saw a lot of it, experienced it with our leadership and our team. So you talk about four key fundamentals of leadership. Can you go through those?
Sure. So these are not the principles. The principles are separate, but there's kind of key fundamentals that I think are the bedrock of how you are, you know, ethically as a leader, as a person. You know, so the first one is just, it's got to be righteous. And so, you know, leadership, you know, has to be ethical, it has to be moral, it has to be legal. And, you know, that's really important as well. You know, in my world of intelligence, special operations, that's really important in the business world as well. You know, and so that's key. The second one is, it's got to be difficult. So great leadership is it has to be something that's hard, because anybody can lead when times are easy, you know, and there's 1,000 examples of that. But it's when times are tough, you know, when it's difficult, that's when you see kind of really, really great leadership. The next I talk about is it's got to be selfless. And I think that is absolutely key. You know, one of the things I talk about in the book a lot, and maybe we'll talk about later, is the principle of humility. But selflessness is, you know, don't ask others what you wouldn't do. And so that's absolutely key. And the last is, you know, great leadership has to be communicable. I mean, that's such an important part now, because I think leadership has changed so much. You know, when I grew up in the CIA, it was very much like a military organization. You know, you had your boss, and he kind of barked down orders, and it really was he who probably barked down orders. Everything has changed now. So great leaders have to be able to communicate with employees who really demand much more now, and they should. And so, you know, your leadership style has to be, you know, it has to be positive. It's really important. Easy to explain, which is really key. And you have to accept negative feedback sometimes. And so kind of those key four fundamentals, I think, are really important, even before we get into the principles. But these are just the foundations of great leadership.
Yeah. And, you know, especially that communicable part, you know, if you're leading a team and you know you're pushing them to do some difficult things, sometimes it makes it a lot easier if they understand exactly
the
reasoning behind it. So, and then humility has a big part to do.
Oh boy. Yep. I got kicked in the face a lot. But I think all great leaders do, all great entrepreneurs do, great businessmen and businesswomen. I mean, you're never going to have times, you know, where everything's great all the time. And so I think those who really learn how to lead understand that principle.
Yep. And you can't take it personal. You just take it and learn from that criticism and go, but you can't look at it that way unless you're humble and you're willing to accept other people's critiques for it. So cool. Now let's dive into the principles. So you, like I mentioned, you have 9 of them, but I want to focus on the glue guy, win an Oscar, and be a people developer. And the glue guy really resonated with me, because at my company, we have a lot of those people. They're behind the scenes, making sure everything works, making sure everybody's happy. and they're kind of unsung heroes. And I mean, I try, like you, I try to, you know, in my role as someone who creates content, I try to highlight them and what they do whenever possible, because it's the only way the outside world is going to see. But so, you know, who is the glue guy, and you know, how do you spot them?
So I have to, and I always make this kind of caveat. It's got to be the glue guy or the glue gal. So I always,
yeah, have to now.
It's really important. But look, this is the indispensable member of your team. And everyone has them. You know, I'm a sports nut, so we can have sports analogies. You know, it's the utility, it's the role player on a baseball team. But in the emergency room, my stepbrother is a doctor, he's an ER doctor in Brooklyn. So, you know, when he read the book, he's like, oh, you know, and he actually showed it to all the nurses. Mm-hmm. Same thing. You know, a rock star, you know, surgeon, you know, who's going to save someone's life is never going to be able to do that if the nurses on call didn't kind of prep the patient. So it's finding that indispensable member of the team. But the key part of that is celebrating them. And so often we have superstars, you know, so I was a CIA operations officer. That means I'm on the tip of the spear. I will go out. I will meet an agent, collect valuable intelligence. Maybe I'm working with Special Operations Command. We're tracking a high value target and we grab someone off the street, you know, who's going to kill Americans. And so I get all the kudos, or maybe, the Navy SEAL team. But you know what? What about the support people behind the scenes? Who got us there? Who drove us there? Who flew us there? Who prepped, you know, all the equipment? And so the key on this is when you have success, you have to celebrate those people. Mm-hmm. And I tell in the book, I have all sorts of great vignettes, but there's one vignette that I love and had to do with Afghanistan. So I was a base chief in a war zone in Afghanistan. And we are, you know, kicking ass there. We are taking out, you know, Al-Qaeda and Taliban members, getting huge kudos from back home. So we are 10,000 miles from the United States along the Pak-Afghan border. Now, we have a whole bunch of support personnel. There's a couple of them who are actually literally our cooks, the chefs. And you know, the secret of kind of, you know, the weird world I lived in is actually the food for CIA is pretty good. But the key is we had this incredible operation. We took a high value target off the battlefield. We're having this all hands. And I was like, hold on a second. Make sure to go to the kitchen and grab the two cooks, literally, and get them in here. And by the way, like, there's all sorts of classification issues and I'm breaking all sorts of rules. These are just literally contract cooks. But I brought him in. I said, hey, I want to make sure that you two are celebrated here because we just kicked some ass. And, the entire free world knows what we did. But, you know, if you don't feed us every day, so my guys and gals can't go out, you know, on patrol, or we can't go meet agents or do the things we have to do. None of this happens. So, you know what? You know, we're getting a lot of praise back home, but I want to make sure that you two understand the role you have. And they were stunned. And they're like, hey, chief, you know, that's what they call it. The CI boss is like, no one's ever done this before. It's pretty easy. And so that's what, to me, the glue guy or the glue gal is all about. And so what you do, you have to identify those people as a leader and make sure you celebrate them. And the other thing you should do too, in my view, is you also include them in your decision planning. Because again, it's the support side of the house, you know, for any kind of, you know, unit, whether it's military special operations or in the business world, that support side, you know, what's it in business? Logistics mm-hmm. is everything.
Yep.
Celebrate those unsung folks. And that's what I love talking about. And I think it'll really resonate because that's, you know, this to me is a no brainer, but it's a worth a reminder to people as they run businesses, as they run, you know, units that you got to celebrate these folks.
Yep. I definitely agree. I mean, here we have what we call mm-hmm. our client success managers. They're behind the scenes interfacing with our customers all the time, making sure their experiences are great. We have our tech people behind the scenes monitoring everything. Right. So, and without them, this all doesn't happen. We'll agree with you 100%. So, what qualities are characteristic of the glue guy or glue gal?
Oh yeah, I love that. So the key is selflessness. And so, you know, one of the things that, you know, so it's funny you say that because I'm this crazy type A personality. I mean, I got recruited to the CIA and I was a success, you know, because this is a lot, you know, the same characteristics that we have in special operations personnel. And so you see, you know, maybe I'm a little loud and brash and you know, it's the, hey, send me, I got this. but the glue guy or the glue gal has some of those, but they're also comfortable, you know, working behind the scenes. Mm-hmm. So it's that quality of selflessness. It's that quality of camaraderie and teamwork, not caring who gets the credit. You know, I'll never forget, we were on an operation in the Middle East one time. I was going to meet an agent, and sometimes we have people on the street who are conducting counter surveillance, which essentially means they want to make sure I don't get set up, you know, by a hostile actor. And this one guy, you know, sat for like 13 hours in this Middle Eastern city. And I remember later that night, I met him for a beer at a bar. And I said, "Hey man, that was ridiculous. Like that was awesome what you did." And he's like, "Hey man, you know, that's what we do." So it's a sense of camaraderie and teamwork. And so one of the key things in my principles, you have to build that as well. That's really important. And that's where your glue guy and glue gals, you know, come out. And there's nothing better than having that kind of team where you have those people, you know, you can count on. Cause guess what? When times are tough, you're going to be like, "Hey, I'm okay. But I know everyone else is too." Cause we have those key individuals, in positions who have that sense of selflessness, and team first attitude.
Yep. And can you be a type A personality and still be a glue guy? Yeah. Like, you know, somebody who's very visible, but right. still, you know, be a part of the team.
Well, absolutely. And one of the key things, and I think it obviously depends on kind of the industry and what you're doing, but also people have to be interchangeable as well. And mm-hmm. so, you know, you can have that. But so there's times, you know, for example, with myself, you know, hey, I was told on an operation, you're going to take a support role. You're going to be that guy doing that surveillance on the street for 13 hours, you know, sweating in 105 degree, and you're good with it. You know, sometimes you're up, you know, in the limelight, sometimes you're not, you step back, and that's fine too. And again, it all goes from that sense of selflessness and camaraderie and teamwork, and sense of family. And so, yeah, you can certainly, you know, have an oversized personality, but you know, sometimes you gotta step back and take a different role, and that's just fine. Yeah.
Okay. It's all about pitching in and helping the team. So the next one is win an Oscar. And I think one is especially important during the pandemic where everything could be falling apart, like keeping that composure as a leader. Tell us a little bit about that principle.
So you know, I came up with this principle based on fail. So a lot of my book is based on my failure in certain instances and what I learned from it. And so win an Oscar is just the sense that when times are tough, everyone is looking at you as a leader, and how you respond is really important. Now it's not to say you can show, you know, compassion and empathy, and you can also be honest and saying like, "Hey, you know, this is going to be tough right now." But the bottom line is everybody is looking at you. And so, you know, the leaders really do set the tone for the rest of the team. And I have so many great examples, but you know, one of them was, again, I go back to Afghanistan, and you know, I went out on patrol with the base that I led. Now, these are some of the toughest men and women on the planet. These are veterans of Black Hawk Down and Tora Bora, the fight against, you know, against Al-Qaeda, you know, veterans of, you know, Navy SEALs and Green Berets, and they ended up joining the CIA and they work for us. And so I went out on a patrol. I was up for 36 hours. So I come back and, you know, I go into the mess hall and I'm tired. Now, usually I would sit with everybody and I was really, I actively wanted to foster that sense of, you know, family. But you know what? I was dead tired. So I literally went and took my child, went and sat by myself. And it was like the world ended. Now, these are the toughest people on the planet, but they're like, "What's wrong with Mark? Is he mad at us?" And I was looking at myself. I'm like, "Oh my God, are you kidding me? These babies, like, are you nuts?" And first of all, these are really tough guys. But then I thought about it, because like, this is what you got to do as a leader. So I thought about it. I'm like, "Hold on a second. I didn't tell them that I was just tired. You know, I didn't tell them that nothing, the base nearly fell mm-hmm. apart. So I had to, you know, I called an all hands around the fire pit at night. And I said, Hey everyone, like, I was just tired. Like, I know I'm not mad. But I learned from this too, because, you know, sometimes I got to take a knee and take a break, and I'll just tell you, hey, you know, I need some downtime. But it's such a great, you know, principle, because everybody was looking at me, and then, you know, the world kind of ended. And when times are tough, when there are times of adversity, this is really important. And I tell a great story in the book about an operation. I'd left my team and I was back home in the United States. And they were poised to capture a high value target. And we were back in the CIA operations center. And someone came to me and said, "Hey, you know, this it's a little messy right now. Our overhead, our ISR, our satellites, we don't have a clear picture on what's happening. They're recommending a go, you know, on the ground to try to capture this. But, you know, the senior leadership at CIA really isn't sure what to do right now." And they came to me and they said, "What do you think?" So I sat back. I'm like, "Okay, I know my team on the ground. They're well trained. They got all they followed, you know, all the processes that, you know, that we're supposed to go through. I know, I have good, you know, even though they think it's a lack of situational awareness, I'm pretty good with it." And so the senior leadership at CIA came to me and said, "What do you think?" I said, 100%, it's a go. And they're like, "Seriously? Like, how can you make that?" And I'm like, "Cause I got confidence in these guys." And they said, "Hey, if this gets screwed up, your career's on the line." I'm like, "Fine, no problem." And they gave the approval and the operation was successful, but it was that kind of aura of leadership that I kind of gave forward. And it wasn't fake. It was real. but boy, you know, I won an Oscar that day. And that's, I think that's so important. And later on, as I wrote the book and I thought about the principles, I was like, I got to put this down because it is so important. At times when there is a lack of situational awareness, where there are times of ambiguity in that gray, people are going to look to you.
Yeah. And like you mentioned before, communication. It's so, if you would have communicated in the beginning that you were just out of it, you needed some alone time, it would have solved that problem ahead of time. So excellent. So the next, the last one I want to talk about is being a people developer. And this is, I mean, this is really all about developing the next generation of leaders. But the approaches that you talked about in a book, I really liked, you know, the way you kind of give them a little opportunity to exercise leadership. Can you give us some details on that?
So you know, I think about my career, and this is how I came up with this principle. So I think about my career and what I accomplished. And I have a, you know, back down in my basement, I have a, you know, a glass case with all these fancy medals. I was at a very successful career as an operations officer. But what am I really going to be remembered for? And that's how I developed those under me, you know, the next generation, you know, passing the torch and developing leaders. And so, I really kind of took that to heart. And even now when I talk to, you know, colleagues who are still in, I had a book signing the other day and someone came up to me, his current CIO officer. He said, "You were the best leader I ever had." And I got really kind of choked up by it, but it was, I really thought about why, but it was training people and teaching them how to lead. And so, I give a great example. When I was a base chief in Afghanistan, again, I would have to go, I was in Eastern Afghanistan. I'd have to go to Kabul, the capital, for a couple of days. So I'm getting on a helicopter. And what I would do is each time I had to leave, I had a deputy who was there, but what we also agreed upon was we were going to name a line officer, one of the rank and file. They were going to have for 48 hours a chance to lead the base, and they're doing everything. And I would say, okay, say, hey, you're going to lead today. And so I'm getting on the helicopter and this one officer, I said, the base is yours for 48 hours. I'll be back. He said, I'll hold down the fort. I was like, wrong answer. I said, I want to come back and I want every decision to have been made. You got this. And so why is this important? And sometimes they screwed up a little bit and that's okay. But when times are tough later on down the line, this all goes back to that period of gray. I know the team I've developed are not only great officers, they also know how to lead. And they have that confidence. And so, the people develop, that's what we're going to be remembered for, is passing that torch. I really kind of took that to heart. And because at the end of the day, that's your legacy, is going to be how you develop others. You know, I have a lot of fancy hardware and it's great. And, I go down there and, scotch in my hand and, think, hey, this is awesome. I was the greatest, but that doesn't matter. It's how you pass the torch to the next generation. Because that's another 20 years where the CIA could be really good. And this will work for the private sector as well. There is no doubt. Be a people developer, mentoring and teaching others, man, that's so important.
Yeah, I like that. I really like that, especially the fact that you actually gave them a chance to learn by actually doing it, by doing the job, even though they weren't appointed officially, but let them get in there, get their feet wet, let them make mistakes now.
Right.
And learn from that. So yeah,
absolutely.
Okay, yeah. Great. So, parting thoughts, for those aspiring to a leadership position, what any key takeaways?
Sure. So the one thing that I really kind of stress all the time is that concept, that trait, that characteristic of humility. Mm-hmm. It's really important. So again, I lived in this kind of crazy type A world, but it was also a world where we did make mistakes and you learn from them. And so, I was a member of kind of an elite group, which is the CIA operational cadre, just like the Navy SEALs or the Green Berets. But you know what? We make mistakes and you can't believe your own hype. And think about that is in the private sector too, in business, when things out of your control happen. And so that concept of humility is so important. And so the parting thoughts, my parting thoughts are embrace that. That's not a sign of weakness. Mm-hmm. Being humble is actually a really good characteristic because it's how you learn from that failure, that where you're going to succeed down the line. And so, be open-minded, accept criticism, talk to your teammates, talk to the people, in your work unit, and stay humble. And that's going to really help you go a long, long way in business and in life.
Great stuff. Well, thanks again, Mark. Everybody, Mark Polymeropoulos, Clarity in Crisis. Good luck on your book tour, and maybe one day in the future we'll get together at Vienna Inn for a couple of beers.
There you go. Absolutely.
All right. Thanks again.
Thanks.